can't think of anything outside of, you know, what you've already got.
Do you want me to do that, or you want to do it?
I'll do that.
Okay. So I'll stop right here. Yeah. No, I'll stop right here. You do the scripture.
Yeah.
Good morning. Yeah, you can hear it this morning. All right. We have a few announcements that we want you to be mindful of. Church Council has, since a need arose for the month of February, we are also doing the warming shelter here during the month of February. So if you can go online and sign up on the sign-up sheets or call the church office. I noticed the other day that there's still lots of slots available for the month of February. You can work from 5:30 to 8 as a person who helps sign in, helps feed, and as the greeter. Or you can choose to work all night, sleep here with everyone. Or you can choose to come in at 7 in the morning and help clean up. That's a very important ministry to those in our community who have no place to go. And so I encourage you to get involved in that ministry. Today, the sanctuary flowers are given by Mary Younger in loving memory of her husband, Ron, and we thank you for those. United Men's Methodist Breakfast, Methodist Men's Breakfast, I guess it can be in any religion breakfast, will be at Maddie May's at 8 a.m. On Thursday, February the 2nd. We also remind you that we'll be looking for someone who can try to replace Alex, who's leaving when she has her child. And we're having a baby shower for her next week. And I think that's the announcements this week. If you will pay mindful consideration to bringing the light in the sanctuary, which is the symbol of bringing Christ into our worship. Thank you.
Thank you.
blessed to have Tristan here to play, and we're blessed to have an organ that can just light up our world whenever we hear it. So thank you. We also had our first lesson in perseverance this morning with the lighting of the candles. Good job in hanging in there until you got the job done. So thank you. I know it's not always easy, and I know it's even worse when you have all these people staring at you. So you did a great job. All right. Let's recite our opening prayer in unison, please. It can be found in your bulletin. To you, O God, we lift up our souls. To you we offer our praise and prayer, our worship and thanksgiving, even our very lives. Make your ways known to us, for you alone are the God who saves, the God in whom we trust, and the one on whom we wait. Amen. If you'll join us in singing our opening hymn, page 400, Come Thou Font of Every Blessing. Almost a call to join the choir, isn't it? Turn tune my heart to every singing thy grace. Anyway, we invite you to join the choir and make a joyful noise with us. But now if you'll turn to page 887 for our affirmation of faith. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No. In all things we are more than conquerors through the one who loved us. We are sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. All right. If you will remain standing as we sing Bear Us, Lord Jesus on page 189.
You may be seated. You all have been standing for a few minutes. You get the award for calisthenics this morning, being able to withstand. As we come to today's scripture, we're going to be looking at the book of Philippians, chapter 4, reading verses 4 through 9 in Paul's letter to the church at Philippi. Always be full of joy in the Lord. I say it again, rejoice. Let everyone see that you are considerate in all you do. Remember, the Lord is coming soon. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray. Pray about everything. Tell God what you need and tell Him and thank Him for all He has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which will exceed anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. And now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Think about these things that are excellent and worthy of praise. Keep putting into practice all you've learned and received from me, everything you heard from me and saw me doing. Then the peace of God will be with you. Friends, this is the word of God for you, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Friends, as we come to a time of sharing our joys and concerns, I have a few concerns that I would like to have you be made aware of so you can be praying not only here in our service, but ask that you pray for these throughout the week as you are able to remember them. Please remember Jeff Walker. His dad, Dan, died suddenly on Friday morning. So I know that Jeff and Jennifer would appreciate your prayers. Those arrangements have not been made yet, but we will announce those when we are able to find those out. And please remember Scotty and Lisa Mayfield. Scotty had some surgery earlier this week, but is doing well. And I know that they would appreciate your continued prayers for them. Are there other concerns that we would like to bring before one another this morning? Wanda Talent, who has had a stroke, we will remember her. Are there others? Are there any joys that you would like to share this morning as we come together? Y'all are a quiet group this morning. Carlton. Yes, we had 50 young adults, teenagers, and some tired adults that went with the resurrection group. And we had an amazing weekend together. There was a spirit of God that was very present, and that leads into a praise. I shared with the choir this morning, and you may have seen in the email that today at 11 o'clock, we will celebrate 7 baptisms coming out of resurrection. Five of those will be joining the church today, and so that is a huge celebration. And if you feel like it, you can even clap for that, because that is huge. 7 baptisms and 5 new members. And 2 of those are Tennessee Wesleyan students as well. So we are grateful that God's Spirit is moving among our young adults in the church as well. I spoke to Holly Enton earlier this week, and she wanted me to make sure you all are thanked for your cards and your prayers for her and for Brenda Clanton. They are so appreciative of the care that you have given them in Brenda's illness, and pray that they can get back here soon. But they know that they are loved by this congregation, and we thank you for all your care for them. Anything else before we go to God in prayer? Let us prepare our hearts for this experience of prayer. God, indeed, this is the time of worship that is set aside for you to meet with your people and for us to convene with the creator of the heavens and the earth, the one who loved us enough to breathe life into us. God, this is a time that is set aside to give you thanks for sending your son Jesus to the world in order to live and to die for the sacrifices of our sins. And God, this is a time that we celebrate the Holy Spirit that is living in your world and alive in our church. This is a time of worship that we stop and we give you thanks for meeting us in this place, for sending your Spirit to come and to intercede on our behalf in our prayers, and for being together with each other this morning. God, indeed, we offer our praise and our prayer, our worship and our thanksgiving to you for our very lives. And God, it is our prayer that during this time that we are centering our thoughts upon you, that you would come to us, that you would surround us with your presence, with your grace, that you would allow us to know the depth of your love and your understanding for each one of us. God, you are the one who gives us life. You are the one who saves. And we pray that we would continue to trust in you during the hardships of life and during the times of joy, that we give you thanks. God, we have lifted those concerns this morning. We especially lift up the family of Jeff Walker in the death of his father, and pray that you would be with Jeff and his family as they grieve, that they may find the hope of your resurrection, the strength of your love that is present with them. For those that are suffering illness, for those that just feel lost, we pray for your continued presence, your peace to fill their lives. And God, would you give us joy? Would you allow us to celebrate the faithfulness of your love? Would you allow us to celebrate the way that you are continuing to lead us as your people? God, we confess our need of you this morning. We confess our sins and we ask for your forgiveness. And God, as you restore us to new life, may you also renew within us a desire to serve you in this world. We say a prayer this morning as you taught your early disciples to pray. And we pray these words by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, we continue to worship this morning in the giving of our tithes and our offerings, knowing that this is an act of worship that we give back to God.
God, indeed, we give you the praise and glory this morning. Receive these gifts in the heart of the giver, and may these be used to further your kingdom in this world. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Would you pray with me, please? Oh God, be our light unto our path and allow us to be able to see the light that gives us enough light to take one more step. We pray in the name of Christ our Savior. Amen. Friends, it's funny sometimes to think about the phrases that we use. Phrases that we use that may have an alternative meaning to them and may not make a lot of sense if we think about it. For instance, the phrase, I love you from the bottom of my heart. And what does that really mean? I love you from the bottom of my heart? Maybe the phrase, take it with a grain of salt. Anybody ever use that phrase? Just take it with a grain of salt. Take what with a grain of salt? What are we supposed to be doing and what are we supposed to be understanding? The KFC allows us to come up with the phrase that it's finger-licking good. That is not a very hygienic thing for us to be doing these days, is it? And finally, probably my favorite phrase, don't throw in the towel. Don't quit. Don't give up. Don't throw in the towel when it gets hard. And I think as we've been thinking through this faith or fear, as we've been looking at different scriptures and different people in scripture that allows us to understand what it means to have faith, I think we need to understand today how we can have faith and not throw in the towel. How we can have faith and not give up when things get challenging or when things get tough. Today I want us to consider the Apostle Paul. How he was brought up in a very perfect life almost. He had very few challenges as he was growing up, attended the best schools, had the best education that he could have. And Saul was one that was very passionate about persecuting Christians. He was very Jewish in his understanding of the law. So Saul, when he met Jesus on the road to Damascus, his life was changed, was it not? Did a 180, completely different from where he was. And even though he had this amazing encounter with Jesus, he was initially rejected by the disciples who didn't trust him. They didn't understand the work that God had done in Paul's life. Had even changed his name from Saul to Paul. The circumstances of his life said one thing, but Paul refused to throw in the towel. Paul refused to give in to the frustration of trying to understand what it was like in being a disciple of Christ. In 2 Corinthians 11, Paul begins telling the church at Corinth everything that had happened to him over the years of being a disciple for Jesus. He said he was beaten more times than he could count, that he faced death many times, that he was beaten with rods, that he had 40 lashes minus one, that he had been stoned, that he was shipwrecked three times. I mean, the list goes on and on and on. He'd been in danger from rivers, from robbers. He had just had such an amazing hard time in being a disciple of Jesus. And even though he experienced danger, he could have thrown in the towel, but he didn't. 2 Corinthians 4 says this, that we are experiencing all kinds of trouble, but we aren't crushed. We are confused, but we aren't depressed. We are harassed, but we aren't abandoned. We are knocked down, but we are not knocked out. You see, Paul endured hardship. He endured things that you and I probably would not experience in life. He endured these things, and he could have thrown in the towel, but he didn't. He endured. He persevered. 2 Corinthians 12, he says, therefore, I'm all right with weakness, with insults, with disasters, harassments, and stressful situations for the sake of Christ, because when I'm weak, then I'm strong. Did you hear what he said? That when he was weak, he found the strength of God giving him, empowering him, and getting to the understanding of where his strength lied in God. Paul comes to the end of his life, and he's imprisoned. He's waiting trial in Rome. He's gone through so much in his life, and he could have thrown in the towel. He could have been all negative, but he wasn't. Instead, in Philippians 4, he says, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Now hear that again. Rejoice in the Lord when? Always. Again, I say rejoice. See, how was Paul able to be positive even when he was being persecuted? How was he able to withstand all that he encountered? And refused to throw in the towel. He could have quit. He could have just gone home. He could have just said that it was too hard, that it was too hard being a disciple of Jesus and thrown in the towel and given up, but he didn't. I think it's interesting that in every book that Paul wrote, he ended with the sharing of God's grace. Something to this extent, he ended with every book, "The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with all of you." See, Paul knew it wasn't his strength that he found. Paul knew that it was all dependent upon the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ that had given him the strength to do what he needed to do. It wasn't Paul. It was God. So the question is this: how do we keep from throwing in the towel when things get difficult? How do we keep from giving up and giving in to the pressures that come in our life? Well, it's interesting, as I was thinking through this week, I think the answer lies in the perspective that we're able to have every day. For instance, one day it was so beautiful outside, almost 70 degrees, right? Here we are in January, it's 65, 70 degrees. Feels so good outside, you just feel that sunshine beating down. Y'all with me? Feels good, right? In my perspective, well, it's supposed to rain tomorrow. All day, it's supposed to rain. Yeah. Enjoy it today, because it's going to be bad tomorrow. It's all about perspective, friends. You got to laugh at how ridiculous I am sometimes. You got to take each day as a way to celebrate God. You've got to be enjoying the moment, enjoying today, and celebrate what God is doing now instead of worrying about what is going to happen. How many of you all could say this morning that you would like to be less anxious about things in life? How many of you all could say that you would like to be more thankful? Yeah. What about those who would like to have more peace about situations in their life? Maybe you would like to connect with God as the source of all goodness in life and have a deeper understanding of God. Well, it's all these things that Paul is gifting us with in Philippians 4. It's all of these things that Paul is saying. Would you like to be less anxious? Would you like to be more thankful? Would you like to have more peace? Would you like to connect with God? Would you like to embody what it's like to be a follower of God? Philippians 4, 4 through 9. Has the answer for us. If we can learn to rejoice in the Lord always, it will allow us to overcome the anxiety we have in our life. If we're able to rejoice in the Lord always, our hearts will be filled with thanksgiving and our being will be able to give thanks for what God is doing. If we can learn to rejoice in the Lord always, the peace of God will fill our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. If we're able to rejoice in the Lord always, we can celebrate God's goodness. And we can have a style of life which embodies the gospel, which allows us to live out the truth of what God is doing in our world. But we can't throw in the towel. We've got to learn to rejoice in the Lord always. Not just when it feels good. Not just when it's convenient. Or not just when it's a day that just is perfect. Paul says we should rejoice in the Lord always. Friends, I want you to hear a testimony this morning. I've invited Pat Chester to come and share some words with us this morning, and I feel like having these testimonies that deal with faith over fear have been helpful for us to understand how we can place our trust and our faith in God. So would you receive Pat this morning?
Thank you, Melissa. You gave me a great lead-in for this little testimony, overcoming fear or overcoming faith with fear. or overcoming fear with faith. I'll get it right. I promise. Just bear with me. You know how I am. The time that I learned to overcome my fear with faith was in 1982. Some of y'all will remember that, and some of y'all were a big part of that. In 1982, I was 32 years old. I was married to Rick Chester. He was 33 years old. We had one son, John. John was 4, and I was pregnant with our second child. I was about 4 months pregnant. Rick went in for a little surgery, we thought, on his thigh. He had a little mole. We learned later it was cancer. It was melanoma. It was stage 4. We had a lot of fears. We knew that our friends and family would help us, but our friends and or our family lived far away. But our greatest fears at the time were we knew we needed more surgery. Who was going to do it? Where would it be? Would he have, what would his recovery be like? And would he have therapy? And what would that be like? We had a fear of his life expectancy. Now remember, we hear of melanoma now fairly a lot. But in 82, that was a new word for us. We had not heard that before. So we researched it. The first person we heard that had had melanoma had died a few months after their diagnosis. So we had great fears of Rick's life expectancy. Would he even be alive to see our unborn child born? And then we had fears for my health. Would the stress for me be a detriment in my pregnancy? But besides our fears for our health, we also had financial fears. I was a stay-at-home mom. Rick was an attorney. And I know to a lot of people that means money. But to us, it meant that he was self-employed. If he didn't work, we had no income. And I don't know about you, but in our early 30s, we had life insurance, but we didn't have enough to sustain us if Rick had passed away. And we knew he could not get any more. Rick also had a great fear, being in a small town, would his clients and people in town even want to use his services because they would heard that he had cancer, and would he live long? And like I said, we had the moral support and prayers from our family, but since they didn't live close, we knew we needed support here. We were in our 30s, as I said, and we had never known anybody that had been diagnosed with cancer. Would our friends and family, would they even know what we needed? Did we even know what we needed? But boy, were we wrong. You, our Keith family, came and supported us. You gave us that faith that we needed to overcome our fears. You found the best doctor for us. We traveled to Birmingham. And I know it's not done this way now, but then we stayed in the hospital a whole week. So you found someone for me to stay with, a loving family, so I wouldn't have to go to a cold motel every night. You kept our son. You not only kept him, you kept him happy. That was one fear we didn't have. You contacted people you knew in Birmingham to come visit us. They took me out to dinner. They prayed with us. They sat with me during the surgery. And you sent cards. Now remember, this was in the 80s, so there was no texting. I don't even know if we had emails back then. We certainly didn't have a laptop for me to take. You sent so many cards, I can remember one day counting 20 cards. It was awesome. We cherished each one of them every day they came. That was our lifeline to our faith. You didn't even ask us, but you came to the house. You mowed our grass. It was in June. You came and picked our garden. And that year, we had a bumper crop of green beans. You picked 5-gallon bucket after bucket after bucket of green bean. And you not only picked them, but you broke them and you canned them for us. When we did come home, we came home to this wonderful sign on our back door to welcome us. And then you came and visited. And of course you brought food. I don't know about you, but John would always ask, Mama, what's for dinner? But not then. He'd say, Mama, who's bringing dinner tonight? And I can go on and on and on and on with the things you did for us during that time. But you strengthened our faith to overcome our fears. Let me repeat that. You strengthened our faith to overcome our fears. Now, for those of y'all that don't know the rest of the story, Rick did live to see our baby girl born, Alice Ann, and he lived to see her turn 16. He passed away, and he lived very healthily during that time, too. We were very blessed. A few days after she turned 16, the Lord did take him home. That's been 24 years ago. And during that time, you, my church family, has continued to bless me. The times that should have been happy were hard for me because Rick wasn't there to celebrate. You were there for our children's graduation, for their marriages, to see them, the loving spouses that they married. You were there for each one of our grandchildren that were born. That in itself helped me again that faith can overcome your fears. And I remember, of course I remember, when Rick passed away, I really didn't have a lot of fears because you had taught me to strengthen my faith. You continued to show your support, and you do now. When the Lord brought David into my life, you have welcomed him into the Keith family. And you have supported our relationship. I will be forever grateful for the strength you have given me to teach me that faith truly does overcome your fears. Thank you.
Thank you, Pat. That was the end of my sermon. It really is. You can look up here and it says the end of the sermon is the testimony by Pat. But I can't help but think that her words have inspired us as a church to be one who practices putting our faith over our fear. To be ones who are not afraid to serve those in our community that may be hurting. And you do that as a church. You have done that to you have not only supported Pat and her family. I shared with you Holly and Brenda earlier in this worship service. They feel the love from you as a church. And I know there's a lot of negativity around. I know there's a lot of negative things about the church, and there's concerns about what we're going to do as a church, as a Methodist Church, and I know that there's a lot of things that can make us afraid. But friends, take today as an example. We have 7 young adults that are being baptized in the faith that are joining this church, not because of their stance on any social issue. Their stance is that you have loved them, supported them, have nurtured them, and this is their home. That's why they're being baptized in this congregation. So my challenge to myself and to you is to continue practicing our faith. Allow it to be greater than our fear. And allow God to do something with it. And allow God to do something through us. Would you pray with me? Oh God, would you allow us to continue to worship you in spirit and in truth? Allow you to be filled with the praise and the glory that you deserve. God, would you continue to allow us to learn what it is to put our faith over our fear? That in difficult times that we would trust and we would cling to your strength. And allow us to celebrate what you're doing in our church. And the larger piece of what you're doing in God's kingdom. For it's in the name of Christ that we pray. Amen. Friends, we're going to conclude our worship today by singing hymn number 354, I Surrender All. This is a hymn of commitment, so if there is something that you would like to be in prayer for, you are welcome to come here to the altar. I'd be glad to pray with you. If there is a commitment that you would like to celebrate before God and this congregation, I'd also welcome that response this morning as we stand together and we sing.
Thank you.
Because I love you, I am not going to share my cold germs with you. I'm not going to shake your hand.